Hi. In this episode, I'm going to be talking to you about the follies of forecasting using CAGR, compounded annual growth rate. If you're a finance professional, you most likely already know what is CAGR. It is simply the geometric mean of the annual growth rate of a variable. In this episode, I'm not going to be talking to you about how to calculate CAGR or what is it supposed to be, but I'm going to be specifically focusing a lot on the issues when it comes to using CAGR for forecast. But before going into that, let's indeed briefly look at what is CAGR and why do we use it. So here I have data about performance of an investment for over a period of 5 years. At the beginning, we invested 100,000, which grew at 75% in the first year, but then subsequently it went up and down, and eventually at the end of fifth year, it was at 102,000. Now, if we were to summarize the performance of this investment, how do we do it? One thing we can do is to calculate the arithmetic rate of returns. In other words, the simple average of the annual rate of return. When we calculate the average, we come to 10%. But if we look at the investment values, we invested 100,000. At the end of fifth year, when it matures, we got 102,000. That's barely 2% over a period of 5 years. But when we look at the arithmetic mean, that tells us it's around 10% per annum. That sounds like an outright joke, isn't it? And this is where CAGR can be useful. Now we're going to calculate CAGR by taking the year ending value or the period ending value, which is 102,000, divided by the initial investment, which is 100,000, raised to the power 1 by n. N here is the number of years, which here is going to be 5 years. And the whole minus 1, that comes to around 0.397%. This is roughly 0.4% per annum is the answer we get. This is more reflective of what we've got over a period of 5 years, isn't it? So that means it's very clear when we're analyzing performance of an investment in the past, CAGR gives us a much better understanding, or it is a much better metric compared to arithmetic mean. Having said that, as an analyst, we don't just look at the past data to know how things happened in the past. We also want to use it to estimate what could happen in the future. So if I were to ask you a question as to what is the expected rate of return for year number 6, assuming our investment performs in line with the past, what would be an unbiased estimator for this? Here is where most of financial practitioners make a mistake. They believe that because CAGR is a better metric to analyze the past, it is also a very useful estimator for the future. Now, let's understand the problem with CAGR, and then I'll come and talk to you about what we should ideally be doing here. If you look at CAGR, our calculation looked at only two data points, the one at the beginning and one at the end. The path that our data took was completely ignored by CAGR. However, when you're trying to forecast what could happen next year, this path matters, right? And that is where CAGR would be less useful to us in this case. In fact, there have been many papers that have been published which clearly establish that a useful estimator, or I should say a more unbiased estimator in this case, would be the arithmetic rate of returns. So does it mean that CAGR is completely a useless metric when it comes to estimating the future? Well, that's not right too. A CAGR would be very useful if you are estimating a point data sometime very much into the long term. For example, if someone were to ask us what would be the value of our investment at the end of 15 years, in that case, we wouldn't be using the arithmetic rate of return. It would be more appropriate to use the CAGR. So we would simply be concluding that the future value of our investment 15 years from now is going to be 102,000, which is our current value, times 1 plus CAGR to the power 15. So when you're forecasting a point data sometime very long term into the future, you can still use CAGR, because in that case the path doesn't matter. But wherever path matters, using CAGR could give us very wrong results. I'm going to illustrate this to you with another example. Let us take this hypothetical case. So here is the land of Lilliput, where the electric vehicle market is expected to be at 900 million in 2020. We expect this market to mature by 2030, and by that time, we expect this market to touch 18,000 million. In other words, 18 billion. So now we have the two point data, 2020, which is 900 million, and for 2030, which is 18,000 million. Question is, what should we take as data for the in-between period? When I ask this question in training, most training participants suggest to use CAGR. So what they suggest is that we should compute the CAGR for the period, which is going to be 18,000 divided by 900 to the power of 1 by 10, because there is 10 years involved here, minus 1. That gives us a CAGR around 35%, 34.9% to be precise. So their suggestion is, once we get the CAGR, let's take the first year value and multiply it by 1 plus CAGR to get the second year value and apply the same process all the way till 2030. When I do that, I have a path here from 900 to 18,000. Now, why do I say that this is not the right path or this is not the right way to do it? Let's plot this data in a chart and let's see how does it look. When we plot it in chart, we notice that this chart is clearly exponential, or in other words, it's concave upwards. As each year passes, the sales grows at a much higher value every year. But when you look at business life cycle till its maturity, you notice that the economic theory shows the path to be concave downwards. In other words, we expect the growth rate to keep coming down over a period of time, not a concave upward or an exponential path. For example, let's look at this internet penetration data in US over the past several years. We can very clearly see that this data is concave downwards rather than being exponential or concave upwards. How does it matter, whatever path the data takes? Well, it matters because different path could produce different results, especially when you're trying to do analysis such as NPV or IRR. Let's look at this for example. Using CAGR, whatever we have forecasted, when I'm trying to look at the CAGR, that's well 34.9%. When I look at the net present value of these values at a discount rate of 10%, which I've just taken as a proxy here, we see that the net present value works out to something like 30,000 million, or in other words, 30 billion. On the other hand, if I were to assume that this data follows a logarithmic path, you notice that the CAGR is still the same, but the net present value almost doubles. In fact, if I expect this path to be more steeper, if I want to take a more steeper logarithmic path, you notice that the NPV is even higher. So if my data is going to follow such a steep logarithmic path, and if I were to model it under CAGR, I'm going to probably underestimate this project's true potential. Even in the medium term, when you're forecasting, the cycle comes into picture. For example, let's look at the past automobile sales data in the US market. You can see here, over the last few decades, it's clearly been cyclical. It goes up in economic boom and it comes down in bad periods. Now, if I were to model this EV sales also to follow a cycle, you notice that again, I come to a slightly different results. And in fact, the number of cycle that's likely to be present here or to be prevalent here is going to affect my result as well. If I increase the number of cycles, you see the NPV I get is something else. In fact, if you're really forecasting something very well into the long term, then we would argue that even data that looks exponential in the initial stages will eventually start following a logarithmic path. In other words, they will start following an S-curve. And when I plot this data in an S-curve, I see a much different result once again. It is also possible that the data simply follows a linear path. In that case, again, I have a very different results. So what we need to understand here is that different path our data follows may all produce same CAGR, but they're going to give different results. So to summarize, CAGR is a very useful metric when you're trying to analyze the past performance, especially in terms of investment performance. But when it comes to using CAGR as an estimate for a near-term growth rate, it is incorrect because in the near term, path matters. You may also use CAGR to estimate point value sometime very long-term into the future, but wherever path matters, using CAGR could give us very misleading results. I hope you found this video useful. I'll meet you next time again with a new topic, trying to offer you a slightly different perspective. Until then, see you and take care.